3, 2, 1. We'd like to welcome you to another edition of Grok Talk, brought to you by New Hampshire's leading conservative blog site, GraniteGrok.com. We are your feared, extremist, right-wing, hard-charging, gun-toting, opinionated, outspoken, rabble-rousing, letter-writing, radio microphone-stomping conservatives and rational libertarians. So get ready for more news and opinion you could only get from GraniteGrok.com.
Grok Talk.
Well, we'd like to welcome you back to whatever it is that passes for normalcy here at Grok Talk, live from the CNHT studios in Concord, New Hampshire. We are back in the studio after 3 weeks on the road, and I couldn't be happier. We have Skip Murphy here, of course.
Hello.
Co-founder of GraniteGrok.com, and Mr. Mike Murphy at the end of the table.
Mike Murphy?
Mr. Mike Murphy. Mr. Mike Murphy. Mr. Mike Rogers.
He's the head of a Bush super
PAC. Wait, you're Skip Rogers, and he's Mike Murphy. I keep forgetting.
Well,
and so do a lot of our readers, apparently. If we show up individually instead of together, they can't tell one from the other.
They have mustaches.
Yeah. They're all gray.
And I keep telling everybody.
And glasses.
Mine's not quite gray yet, but I'm getting there.
I keep telling everybody. Skip's mustache and hair is more luxurious than mine, but...
All right, well.
Thank you very much.
Bushier,
thank you very much.
There you go.
But Bush is probably a bad word.
Coming on the program today, Andrew Hemingway. He's on the line waiting for us to stop fooling around. Ed Nail's going to join us to talk about Carl Gibson's indictment. Max Abramson is in to discuss some different issues regarding legislation that's coming up in the session. And, of course, we'll try to fit in all the other foolishness, the WTF, and yada, yada, yada. But let's move forward because we're here. We have a guest on the line, and hey, that's what we're here for. Andrew Hemingway, welcome to the program, sir.
Hey, guys. Thank you so much for having me on.
Yep. Glad to have you. So, last week there was this caucus thing that happened in the Durgan Polling Arena at Hopkinton State Fair, and a whole bunch of people showed up. What's your impression of the event, and what do you have to say?
Didn't you actually design the idea, Andrew, as I seem to remember?
Well, yes. I mean, back in January, you know, this is the whole thing. I mean, we as conservatives are terrified about this upcoming presidential election, especially because we have so many, you know, conservatives candidates, you know, candidates who may or may not, you know, truthfully be conservative, but are pulling from the conservative base of the vote. And we see really only one, and maybe with Kasich, two, you know, candidates on the establishment moderate side who are really pulling from that base. And so if the reality, you know, of all of that comes through, then, you know, conservatives are in a real problem because we're going to end up splitting our votes, which, you know, is not a new story for conservatives in elections. When we split votes and the moderate wins, take for instance the U.S. Senate race where we had Bob Smith and Jim Rubens both pulling from the conservative base, and in walks Scott Brown, who, even though he got, you know, a lower percentage than both of their votes combined, ends up winning the nomination. And, you know, I'm just tired of seeing minorities, you know, in the party win seats and go on to represent and claim that they are the Republican Party, when indeed they're actually the minority in the Republican Party. And so we came up with the idea, and we formed the 603 Alliance, and we said, what is a model that we can use that's transparent, that's open, that would allow grassroots conservatives to be able to nominate for themselves a candidate that they were going to align and get behind? And then, with the work of you know, Mike Rogers and a committee of people, Diane Bitter and Fran Wendelboe and leaders in the conservative movement in New Hampshire, got together and we said, let's do this.
And Skip and Steve, too, during the gestation of this.
There were a lot of people involved in all of this. Jim Kofald, I mean, the names go on and on. It culminated in, you know, last Saturday. Over 700 conservatives, grassroots conservatives, showed up and participated in the first ever New Hampshire Greeno grassroots presidential caucus. And, you know, from all reports, it was a smashing success. I think that the actual administration of it, which I was nervous about, went fairly flawlessly. You know, the first round, there was Ben Carson, Ted Cruz, and Carly Fiorina left. And then after that, Fiorina was dropped off, and it was Carson versus Cruz, and Cruz ended up winning. And we as an organization endorsed Senator Cruz at that point and are backing him in his run for president.
And that's cool. And, you know, Andrew, I know I was personally involved in some of the outreach, but I believe many members of the committee were involved in outreach to all of the candidates to get them to either show up in person or send strong representation or hold rallies. And let's make a couple of points here about this event. First of all, it was free, completely free to the attendees. The only thing they had to pay for was food from the food wagons outside at their choice. Everything else was organized, and the only thing the candidates had to pay for was if they wanted space and a tent for a rally outside.
Yeah, and you know, to my amazement, only one candidate decided to engage and to really participate. You know, this is I find this mind-boggling, and then I think about that it's, you know, politics and campaigns, and I probably shouldn't think it's mind-boggling, but. When you go through a straw poll, and you guys, you have to sort of back me up on this, but have you seen absolutely meaningless straw polls? Like straw polls that mean absolutely nothing, and the candidates will buy hundreds of tickets. They'll push. They'll do all of this activity, and at the end of it, all they get is literally a gold star that says, oh, you won the, you know, Republican Liberty Caucus, straw poll. Great, and they walk away. Have you guys seen that?
Yes. Oh, yeah. I've seen it lots of times, and I'm not going to state on the air here, but I've seen frequently who buys the most tickets and to what effect. And I don't quite agree that only one candidate put in the effort, Andrew. I believe that Ben Carson's team put in a pretty good and sincere effort. Dave Tilley's a nice guy and a hard worker. They got a decent number of activists. They had a competent team on site.
Cruz was the only one who came in person.
Yeah, but Cruz was the only one who came in person. You know what? The other thing which again, people maybe didn't realize, do you think I went to the time and trouble of renting a pro-grade projector, building a little walk the plank out from one of the side pillars, and setting up a 12-foot screen that's nearly 15-foot diagonal, just so I could show a few cartoons in the interludes? We exhorted all of the candidates also to send us video clips, anything exhorting their voters to especially ones that became uncommitted, to group around their poll for the next round.
So this is my point about this. This is what I don't. This is sort of the part where there was a disconnect for me, which was, you do the straw polls, you literally get nothing. The winner of the caucus gets the entire organization's endorsement and work. We sign on to the campaign, and we, a unified group, move forward and work with you. You actually get something coming out of this event.
Yeah,
you get nothing. Coming out of these other events that they pour all this effort into.
Yeah, you would have had to tie Zach down to stop him running around with sign-up sheets after that.
Right. It's amazing to me that this is that, and you know, hats off to the Cruz campaign. They're the ones who recognized it. And you know, honestly, I don't know how you guys feel about what I'm about to say, but I gotta say I'm embarrassed by the Rand Paul campaign and their shenanigans in trying to cover their own laziness. I mean, literally, that's what it is. It's their own laziness in trying to say, "Oh well, you know, we're just going to avoid this because, maybe you know, we think that it's rigged." You know, trying to plant these rumors and these ideas that this thing was rigged is absolutely absurd. They know it. They were embarrassed. They had a demolishing loss. The Cruz campaign out-ground gamed them, outworked them, proved to them that Rand Paul really has no ground game here in New Hampshire, that his campaign is nearly inept. And it was an embarrassing show. There were seven people who showed up for Rand Paul. Donald Trump had three times as many people show up. And it's just, I felt like it was an embarrassment for the Rand Paul campaign and a statement of exactly where they're at. When people say, hey, is Rand Paul still running? There's a reason why they're asking that question. Because, you know, apparently they're on life support over there and just waiting for someone to please pull the plug, which this week we heard Mitch McConnell, again, you know, Rand's buddy, you know, this guy that he's decided to endorse and to ingratiate himself to, the senior senator from Kentucky. Rand now is, you know, at his beck and call. And so we see McConnell this week coming out saying, you know, Rand, you really need to focus on your Senate race. Oh, and by the way, you're probably going to have a primary in Trey Grayson again. So, you know, I think the time for Rand Paul is very, very short. And I got to be honest with you, I think that's a good thing for our movement.
Yeah, so in other words, if he wants to have some hope of keeping a Senate seat and staying in the most exclusive club and being Mitch's buddy versus no chance of becoming president, he'd better choose. It's really interesting. You know, I mean, Rand Paul in this state signed up one of the heavyweight campaign organizers and one of the oldest, longest-running, most veteran campaign operatives in the form of Mike Biondo and Dave Chesley. Not that Dave Chesley has ever won anything. But
wait, is this the Dave Chesley of the Lickgate scandal? The guy who was licking reporters' cameras?
I don't remember.
I don't remember that one.
Don't remember that?
No, I do remember him.
Google it.
I do remember him claiming he was in charge of the Republican women at an event at the Crown Plaza a couple of years back.
Guys, he licked the camera. You guys, that was just a few months ago.
I think we did at the time.
He tried to bully Mike and I. That was the wrong thing for him to have done.
Yeah.
that I do remember. He was removed from the room.
And at the Crown Plaza 2 weeks ago, we tried to wrangle the Paul campaign to come and talk to us, about what they were doing and their plans for the caucus and so on. And so I encountered Biondo and Chesley in the lobby, and I talked to them, and I talked to Mike Biondo and persuaded him to come and chat to Steve and myself.
Keep going.
But there was Chesley standing beside him and talk about stony-faced. The man doesn't like me for good reason, and I'm perfectly happy to reciprocate.
Hey, Andrew, we're going to take a really quick break. Stay on the line. This is Grok Talk. I'm Steve McDonald here with Skip Murphy and Mike Rogers, and Ed Nail's ready to do his next segment. We're going to come back with Andrew and maybe talk about some things that happened at New Hampshire Young Republicans in a few minutes. Stay tuned. This is Grok Talk. We'll be right back.
Rock Talk.